Hello, Mr. Arnager. I returned like a Mataraji preaching Christianity Sikhism. Here I'm giving deliberation on the ecclesiastical history by Eusebius. So, but as the preaching of the Saviours Gospel was daily advancing, a certain providence led from the land of the Ethiopian, an officer of the queen of that country. Now that the eunuch, you know, as you can know, this queen was Candace. Candace is the destiny, you know, according to the, not the name of the person, of the destiny of queen who ruled in Meroë, an island formed by two branches of the Nile, south of Egypt. So for Ethiopia, even to the present day, is ruled according to ancestral custom, ancestral custom by a woman. Remember, there are many countries, you know, where the woman, she dominates or she rules over, she has a great influence. She is the kingmaker sometime. We lived in Ghana 14 years. Over there, the woman was the kingmaker. So the kings come from the woman's side. He first among the Gentiles received of the mystery of the divine word from Philip in consequence of a revelation, having become the first fruits of believers throughout the world. He is said to have been the first on returning to his country to proclaim the knowledge of the God of the universe. And the living, life-living sojourn of our Saviour Christ Jesus among men. So he, the eunuch, you know, that Philip met, and that's what he is describing, says that this eunuch returned to Ethiopia and preached there, but by no one else. So far as I know, is the origin of Christianity in Ethiopia traced back to him. The first certain knowledge we have of the introduction of Christianity into Ethiopia is in the 4th century under Frumentius and Ædesius, of whom Rufinus gives the original account, and yet it is probable that Christianity existed there long before this time. Remember that the Christianity in this third world country in Africa and other thing was original, not a book knowledge. We lived in Ghana 14 years. Over there, you know, if somebody is eating food, he won't eat it alone. He will invite everyone, come share the food. Have you seen such a Christianity in the West, where the people eat, they don't share? So that they had, you know, custom which were very original and very God-orientated. Here the custom are mammon-orientated. So that though him in truth and the prophecy obtained its fulfillment, which declares that Ethiopia stretcheth out her hand unto God. In addition to these, Paul, that chosen vessel, not of men, neither through men, but by the revelation of Christ Jesus himself and of God the Father, who raised him from the dead. Remember, you know, Paul, he was, before he was Saul, he learnt it from Gamaliel. He learnt dead letters. So dead letters, then he was devoid of the spirit. So the people of the letters, they hate men of spirit. As the university professor, they hate me, you know. When I tell them things, they don't want to know me. So that is quite normal. So these Gamaliel and all those teachers of that time, they hated those like who were men of spirit. So Christ Jesus, all of a sudden, he appeared with full of spirit. which the common man accepted, but the men of letters rejected. So there you are, Saul was the fruit of Gamaliel, who too hated men of spirit. But in his heart, he was not a hypocrite. He was doing it against his will. His heart, or his flesh did it, but his heart was not willing to do it. So was appointed an apostle, being made worthy of the call by a vision and by a voice which was uttered in a revelation from heaven. That, you know, we all know how in the Acts, you know, that Paul was called to the mission of our anointed elder brother. So when he was called, then he started to preach Christianity straight away. He did not need to go to learn anything, because after this, when he had this experience of lightning, then he got blinded. And that blindness then was his haughtiness or his ego in letters. So in letters he had learned things, you know, but not in spirit. So he humbled himself, and then he begged to be what he should do. Then when his scales came out of the eyes, on the fourth day he fasted. He fasted because when St. Thomas said, "Why should I fast? What sin have I committed? Why should I pray? What wrong have I done?" So Saul had committed sin, you know, by persecuting the people, putting them in jail and all that. So for his sins, you know, he fasted 4 days. So when he fasted, after fourth day, when the scales came off, then they were thick. That thickness showed how he was blind to spirituality. He was drunk with the old wine of the letters, knowing not the spirit. But as his heart was clean and he had learned things, so he was had the mercy of our Father, and so he received the very Spirit of God, the same wage as the other 12 lay workers got it at Pentecost. So he too had the Holy Spirit with capital S. So when he got the Holy Spirit with capital S, he became the twin brethren of all those apostles and of our anointed elder brother, Christ Jesus. So Christ Jesus possessed the very Spirit of God, Holy Spirit. The same Spirit was possessed by all these apostles, and also Saint Paul received it later on, after Jesus had left, you know. So it was the same Spirit making him twin brother. But Saul had a special function to do. He had a good knowledge of the scriptures. So with this knowledge of the Holy Spirit, he could explain the scriptures from the very root and tell them what are their drawbacks and how good is this new wine as compared with this old wine of letters. So that's why he stressed, you know, that in Jesus, this moral law or the Old Testament is an old vessel of the old house, which are to be replaced by the new vessels and new rituals of the new covenant in Christ Jesus. So he rejected this Old Testament. And so Christ Jesus told them not to bring in Jewish leaven. But these corrupt messianic Jews, they brought it in and corrupted the Christianity worse than it was before. This Christ Jesus describes in Matthew 12:43-45, that the house which was cleansed by his blood, the arid evil spirit bring more evil spirits into his house.